Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. We are born into religions because our mother and father, our grandparents, were of that nature. But what happens as you get older and there are other questions that come in that ritual itself does not answer? My guest today, Eric Lax, has written Faith Interrupted, A Spiritual Journey, and it's published by Alfred Knopf. Welcome, Eric.
Hi, Connie. Thank you very much.
And I said we're born into religions. Your father was a minister, your mother a nurse, from England originally.
Yes.
Your father is just one of the great men I've read about.
My father was a really neat guy. He was an Episcopal priest, had come out from England in the 1930s in the Depression to the prairies of Saskatchewan to go to seminary. And his first parishes were on the prairie, and my mother, who had grown up there. And he was a wonderful priest in two ways. One is that he was just a great priest. He could preach a sermon, he could minister well, he had the empathy and the spirituality that you needed. But also he was one of the funniest people I've ever met. And he had a great foot in the world where he could really understand how people lived.
And he used you, I don't mean he used you, but you were his acolyte,
yes.
You were his assistant.
Yeah, from the age of six.
You were practically the little priest.
I was. My father would have been very happy if I had gone into the priesthood, but he knew that it's a calling that you can't be directed into it, but he worked very hard to make sure that my ears were always open.
One of the great aspects of Episcopalian religion, and Wellesley College, where I went, is an Episcopalian school. God is love. That was the opening of every new year for the sermon.
Oh, that's terrific. Yes, that's my father said late in life to me when he was quite ill. He said, the only thing that matters in Christian teaching is God is love. He said, the miracles are window dressing. If you can just remember that everything boils down to it. And that's really how he lived his life. And that lesson is something that stayed with me and something that I've kind of wrestled with as I've dealt with a faith that I was very secure in for so much of my life, to still that notion that love is what really matters in the world.
And we should say, from there, he came to California.
Yes, my mother's hay fever. Well, yep. I wouldn't be in California without my mother's hay fever.
And he was down in Coronado, where my parents had
lived.
Oh,
really?
Yeah, and then came back, ending up in...
He was outside San Diego in what was then a very small village, El Cajon, that had about 5,000 people. Now it's huge, but we went there in 1951.
And he started with a small little church. And then there are scenes where you talk about the community helping to build. And it was almost like something out of, you know, This Is America.
Right. It was sort of like putting together a Quaker meeting house or something. The Amish putting together a barn. One of the things that was great about that, the parish was only a few score people when he came, was actually called a mission, because missions are supported by the diocese and parishes are self-sustaining. And it quickly became a parish. And the church just finally couldn't hold enough people after about 3 years with my dad. And so plans were drawn up. An architect who was in the congregation did the plans. And the men in the congregation and the women came out on Tuesdays and Saturdays and did all of the volunteer labor for 2 years, everything except the plastering and the electrical. Mm-hmm. And there was a great deal of sweat that was poured off of that. And after they had dug the trench for the foundation, there was always food and a beer or something afterward. And my father took an empty can of beer and put it into the hole for the foundation as a kind of a symbol of all the sweat equity that not only had gone into that point, but would. And he said to the people there, he said, with a kind of a gleam in his eye, he said, I would have put in a full can, but I figured the good Lord would have objected to the waste.
But you know, in talking about that or writing about it, for me reading it, that's religion.
Yes.
That's everybody coming and caring.
Yes. Yes. It was a very close parish in those days, and there was a wonderful spirit to it, because everyone was kind of invested in it.
And it wasn't just ritual.
No, it wasn't just ritual. It was the labor, it was the fun, it was the eating the dinner that those who couldn't be carpenters cooked up, and having the beer afterward where you just kind of relaxed and enjoyed the pleasure of hard work.
And then from there, Eric Lax goes to college Hobart.
Yeah, Hobart and William Smith Colleges in Geneva,
in
New York.
Where I had lived at.
No, okay. This
yes,
is,
my father was in the Navy.
No.
And there was Samson.
There was, yes, sure, yeah. Of course, Samson was there.
And colder than whatever during the winter. And your roommate then is a man named Kip.
Yeah, Skip Packard. George Skip Packard. He and I were very similar. We had both grown up in the church. We were both acolytes from an early age. We both really liked the ritual. We were caught up in it. The church had a very meaningful place in our lives. And in college, we were both volunteers in the chapel. We both were still acolytes then. He was one of the really big men on campus. He was in all the honor societies. He was the head of the student body our senior year. And we each were in charge of dormitory. I was the proctor of one, and he was in charge of all of them. And the dorm that I was proctor of had the nicest room, so the two of us ended up living together for a year and had a wonderful time and spent a lot of our time actually talking about God and religion and how we felt.
Which asked me, would you read from there to there?
Oh, of course. I had never spent much, if any time, trying to prove the existence of God. Now much of my days and nights were spent learning how the greatest divines and philosophers did so. In the 11th century, 650 years after Augustine, St. Anselm of Canterbury wrote, Fides quantis intellectum, faith-seeking understanding. By this he meant not to replace blind faith with reasoned understanding, but rather to augment a love of God with a deeper understanding of God. Anselm's were the first definitions of God and of faith that made me stop and think. Anselm claims the proof of God's existence is that God is something than which nothing greater can be conceived. And it continues as a syllogism. If that than which nothing greater can be conceived in the mind, it must exist in reality. Thus, that than nothing greater can be conceived exists in reality, and so God exists.
Which is an interesting sort of bottom line, ergo.
Ergo. You know, it was so interesting. The first 2 years, no matter what your major was, the first 2 years at Hobart and William Smith, everybody took this course in Western civilization that started with the Greeks and ended up through the Reformation. And you studied the Bible, you studied literature, you studied philosophy, and you were able to really see how Western thought came together. And it was a wonderful course for everybody to have. And one of the pleasures in this book, I spent just a few pages on it, but I was able to distill a couple of those courses, not only for my benefit, but I hope for the benefit of the reader.
And of course, there was Aristotle who said, God is the immovable mover.
Yes.
Yeah.
And you know, what's so interesting in this is that this became kind of the fodder for lots of discussions in the student union or when you were hanging around in the dorm at night. And one of the things that I find so interesting now is that having come back, and I spent more than 10 years thinking about this book, probably 15, and a couple of writing it, is that in some ways I'm back to those same discussions that I had in the dorms and with my roommate, just with a lot more life experience to go with it.